What I'd like you to do, because there's only a few of you, let's form a row right here. Everybody's going to be facing Justin. So your ears are going to be on him and your eyes are going to be on him and your ears will be on me. So before you even worry about picking up the bar, let's look at a full thruster. So what Justin's going to do is he's going to jump the bar up onto his shoulders. First, notice the elbow position.
I would always prefer someone else demo, and some of that's a function of a knowledge of my own mobility and athleticism. But some of that is that it's much easier to describe what's happening if you're not thinking about doing it. And so taking Justin in the front of that class and having them look at him and listen to me, one, he's a better athlete, he moves better, and two, it allows me as the instructor to concentrate on telling them what he's doing, not doing it. As far as pulling somebody from the crowd, that's directly a function of how well you know the crowd. You know, if I was going to pull somebody from that crowd, my warm-up, my diagnostic, I probably would have pulled Brandon. The guy in the headband. And because I saw him move, right? He took my verbal cues very well during the warm-up. So I know that if I had explicitly been telling him what to do and when to do it, he would have probably performed what I needed when I needed it. The other thing you'll notice is even with Justin, when I'm cueing him to demonstrate for me, I'm really explicit about what I want, like really explicit. I've got hands on him, I'm telling him exactly what he's going to do, then I'm telling him to do it, and then I'm telling him how to do it as he's doing it, right? So as long as your demo person's listening to you and you're really explicit, you can get most anybody to do that. Now, is there a risk in grabbing anybody from the crowd? Yeah, don't do that. And should you be able to demonstrate these movements yourself in the proper movement patterns? Absolutely. I'm huge on preemptive coaching. Somebody could watch this video and say, man, he sure gives a lot of information. He sure talks a lot. But what I'm trying to do is stop mistakes, technique mistakes, from ever occurring, right? Because in this environment, in the unladen barbell, one step at a time environment, I have the luxury of stopping them at any point in time. I have the luxury of going slow. But when you tell somebody, okay, you're going to do 60 thrusters for time later in the class, I won't have that luxury anymore. And so my job during that warm-up and during that instructional in my mind is to stop as many mistakes from ever occurring as possible. You know, it's like you get in your car, right? And you put on your seatbelt. Why? Well, you haven't crashed the car yet. And we're not going to wait until you crash the car to have you put on your seatbelt. This is very much in that vein. If you can break down a movement, the other thing it does, you're getting the intellectual knowledge you need to perform properly.
So he hits that bounce in the bottom, bounces off his abs, and he stops. And this is where he starts to really try and accelerate this bar. His hips are pushing energy through his torso up, and boom, and that bar almost starts to float on its own. It gets weightless. I want you to think about this. You're trying to jump the bar off your shoulders.
I have to make sure that they're paying attention. And ultimately, that 10 minutes, there was a lot of nuance there. But what does it boil down to? Fast hips, fast hands, right? And if I get those two things, I know I'm gonna get some approximation. So I want, after I tell you to think about X, Y, Z, A, B, C, and W, I've told you to think about too many things for you to actually think about during a movement that takes less than a second, right? Maybe a second and a half. I need you to think about the two takeaways. And so I think that's what I'm doing there. I'm just punching them with the takeaway.
On this rep, don't stop punching ever. Those hands are going up hard, 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 hard. And now they're going up fast, okay? Ready? Down, up, punch hard, punch hard. Nice. You see how far ahead of the bar his head is? See where his ear is in relation to the bar? It's in front of it. Go ahead and now push that bar back here, okay? Now, by way of contrast, this is not tight. As soon as he drives his head forward, it's not the bar back, his head forward, all of this tightens up. The traps, the muscles up of the upper back, everything that's gonna support, you can relax, everything that's gonna support that overhead gets tight. So let's try that real quick.
I was watching that last clip and thinking to myself, I had talked too much there, that there was just a little too much instruction and not quite enough movement going on. But I was commanding that room to such a high degree that they were doing what I asked them to do when I asked them to do it well. and the corrections that I was imposing on a global scale, everyone punched fast. It was happening. And so when you're getting, you need to be married to the result and not the process. And you'll also notice that not only was I getting the result I needed by and large, I'd spent the class up to this point. So it's 8:26 or so on the clock, 8:27 on the clock right now. We started that class at 8 p.m. I'd spent the preceding 15, 20 minutes buying myself the time to do this, right? And I bought it by stacking up. I don't have to worry about their squat right now. I've already worried about it, right? And if I hadn't done that, I might be teaching the squat right now instead of teaching the thruster. And so I'm buying the time to talk. But by and large, what should that balance be? The balance should be whatever the balance needs to be to get the effect you're looking for, which is five people doing thrusters correctly.
We're gonna do a one rep max thruster. That means that this is gonna be laden. Whenever it's laden, I need you to use collars. I also need you to use a certain protocol, okay? This is a fast lift. We don't spot these lifts here ever, okay? If a lift goes wrong, all you do is drop it and get out of the way, okay? Now, as far as racking and unracking the bar, here's what's gonna happen.
So, you know, one of the main criticisms that gets leveled at CrossFit is that it's unsafe. And it's only unsafe if you do stupid shit, right? Like anything. And I find that that's 30 seconds, that 45 seconds, that 60 seconds saying this is how you take a barbell in and out of a rack is simply preempting a possible problem. You know, especially when I look around that room, I have those two young ladies who are just out of undergrad. We're both hockey players who they're not moving tremendously well. You know, they're obviously athletes and doing well. But if I don't go over that at that point, I know that those two are at a larger risk to hurt themselves than anyone who's touched that barbell before. But at the same time, if I've got somebody in there who's advanced, like, hey, I'm just reminding them to put on their seatbelt. And that's never wasted time.